But y'all pray for him as he comes. Just ask the Lord to bless him. Get all over him, Lord. Amen.
Amen. We count it such a great privilege to be back with you once again. And amen. Appreciate the Lord for the wonderful revival we were in last week. We had to kind of cut it short due to a death in the community. Had some wonderful, wonderful services. Saw a lot of folks raise their hand. Amen. Signifying that they were lost without God. Nobody moved, but at least we're glad seed was sown. But if you have a Bible tonight, turn with me to 1 Chronicles chapter 12. 1 Chronicles chapter 12. I'm going to read one verse and then have a word of prayer. The Bible said in verse 32, "And of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do, the heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their commandment." Heavenly Father, most righteous God, Lord, as we come once again tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that name that's above every name, God, I thank you for the privilege to be able to stand one more time behind this pulpit. And God, I pray tonight, Lord, look down upon us and anoint us tonight, God, with the Holy Ghost and with power. Lord, that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart might be acceptable in thy sight. And Father, we'll not fail to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory, for it's in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen and amen. I begin to read this verse, and I thought about the kind of world that we're living in, where so many people, it seems, are at a crossroads in their life. You know, I hear that all the time. You know, prayer request, email, phone call. I'm not sure what I need to do right now. Would you pray for me? I'm at a crossroad. And you know, there's so many different options that are being thrown at people. I mean, you can even go in McDonald's down here, and every time you order something, they want to either get you to add fries with that or supersize it. There are always options, amen, that are being thrown. But as I begin to pray about this scripture, amen, I was just so thankful that there were some men that had understanding of the times and knew what Israel ought to do. And how that there are some things tonight that are not optional. There are some things that God expects of us. No matter if you're a preacher, a pastor, a deacon, a singer in the choir, or just a lay member in the church, there are some things that are not optional. There are some things that are required, expected for all of us if you're going to walk in victory. And I thought about that. And amen, I want to share a few of those with you tonight. Amen. The first thing we find is in, amen, the book of Luke chapter 18, where the Bible said that he spake a parable unto them, unto this then, that men ought always to pray and not faint. In other words, you may not do it. There may be circumstances in your life that would try to steer you away from that prayer time in your closet. But he said, you and I that know the name of Christ, that have a relationship with him, we ought to be praying. And as I look around tonight in the world that we're living in, surely if there's ever been a time that we ought to be doing something, it's the day and age that we're living in. But you know, the Bible said in 1 Peter 5 and about verse 8 that we have an enemy. He said, be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary the devil walketh about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He wants to try to steal that prayer time away from you. I said, well, you really don't need to do that. You know, things are not really that bad. Things are not at the point that you're so desperate, you know, that you need to get in and pray. But I've come to tell you, the devil is a liar. Jesus said men always ought to pray, that they should be a desire in you and I tonight, that regardless of what life throws at us, how busy our schedule is, they should be a desire to get alone and talk to God. Why is that? The Bible said, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And I mean, we can go all the way back to the Old Testament, 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, talking about the promise of prayer, that if my people who are called by my name, I shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. He said, then I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin, heal their wicked land. But you know, a lot of folks today are trying to pick, you know, and divide and cut and say, well, that's really not as necessary as it once was. I don't know what time they see whenever they look out, what kind of situation they're living in, but I still find a need in my life how to talk to him. And I'm glad he said in Jeremiah 33:3, I'll call unto me and I will answer thee. I'm glad there's an interchange that can happen when you still alone and get in the prayer closet. Amen. I said prayer is so important. You know, sometimes I guess we have bad experience carrying a conversation. Have you ever been in a conversation with somebody that really wasn't paying attention and they were nodding their head and saying, yeah, but you knew they really wasn't paying attention? I want you to know you have the attention of heaven this day. Amen. This evening here on this mountain, God is looking down. Amen. Upon you and I. He is such a God of details. The Bible said that he knows every hair of our head. They're all numbered, and before they ask, he said, I'll hear, and I'll answer, and while they're yet speaking, I'll hear. Now that is a God of details. But it just doesn't stop with prayer. You come on over into the book of Acts chapter 5, verse 29, Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than man. Amen. That's something else we ought to be doing. But you know, we allow the pressures, amen, of being politically correct in society. I said, now preacher, there's some guidelines you don't need to meddle with. But the Bible is telling us here another thing that we ought to be doing. We ought to be obeying God and not worrying so much about being socially acceptable, because Jesus said in John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32, when he answered those Jews that believed on him, if you continue in my word, then shall you be my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So we need to be obeying the word of God, to be obeying God rather than men. But I find that there's a pressure on there. I may have told you some years ago, I was over in Kentucky to do a revival. The pastor met me at the door, gave me a piece of paper, and I said, what is this? He said, this is a list of everything I don't want you to touch. I don't want you to mention. I don't want you to get on or deal with. And I thought, my Lord, why'd you even ask me to come? You know, how can I be free and obey God? Now, I would never go anywhere to hurt anybody or tear anybody up. That's not what we're about. But you know, sometimes we need to deal with certain issues. We need to address certain things. Because as men of God, we have a responsibility to say we need to get busy. Like the people in the day of Nehemiah, man, we need a mind to work tonight. To say, I don't know what you're going to do, but I ought to be obeying God. I didn't come here to sit on my seat. I didn't come here to listen to the excuses of the enemy that says, well, they've heard you time and time again. I've come to obey God. God has a purpose and a plan for each and every one of our lives. And if we'll get in and obey God, this can be one of the best services you've ever had. You can leave as David. I said in Psalm 122, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go up into the house of the Lord. But if you sit back and quench the spirit, you'll not leave satisfied. Have you ever went home and got a whooping from the Lord? Amen. Hello out there. I said, have you ever got a whooping because for some reason you stood back? You didn't fully obey God. I mean, now you were there. Maybe you sung along with them, but you fully didn't do what God told you to do. But the Bible said the men of Issachar had an understanding. And I tell you, when I look around in the world this evening, amen, it's not that God is not dealing. I mean, we've got churches on just about every corner. We've got more tools and resources. The internet, radio, TV, all these things to reach people. But folks, you know, are kind of leaving that part out. But I really believe tonight, if we want God to revive us personally and corporately, then there has to be a desire that says, I'm going to obey God. Amen. I've been in some services. You know, things got a little strange. I remember one night a man got down on his hands and knees and he crawled to that altar. Somebody said, Brother Tom, why did you do that? He said, because I sat back there. Amen. And God was just all over me. And he wanted me to testify and I wouldn't do it. And you know, I told him I'll wait. I'll do it some other time. And you know, finally that anointing, that feeling left him. And he got worried, Brother M. And he said, Lord, I'll crawl to that altar if you'll just let me feel it one more time. Lord, I'm not willing to let it pass. I'll obey you next time. Lord, I'm sorry. He began to repent and he got down on his hands and knees. Some said, wow, that man's crazy. But he had a determination. I'm going to obey God now. No matter what it looks like, no matter what anybody else says, because when it really comes down to it, you got to know that we have to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. I can't do it for you. You can't do my job. I can't do yours. But if we'll get in there and cooperate with one mind and one accord, we can have some church tonight. Amen. I said we can have church. We can see people get delivered. People get healed. We can see God add to the church. But if we're not willing to obey God and be faithful in the small things, how can we expect God to bless us with something greater? Amen. It's what God put on my heart tonight. Amen. So we ought to pray and we ought to obey God. Amen. Those are two of the predominant ones. Amen. That we really ought to be getting a hold of. Amen. But not only should we be obeying God, because sometimes there are folks that are weak that are out there that maybe don't have the courage or feel the liberty. He said in Romans 15:1, we then that are strong ought to bear the infirmity of the weak and not to please ourselves. Amen. They ought to be, amen, a hunger in us to come along and help the neighbor that's beside us. Amen. To get in there and just obey God. I can remember years ago when you came to an altar, man, they just swarm right in around you. You never had to worry about praying alone. Folks, they had compassion. Some would be whispering in your ears, everything all right? Amen. How can we pray with you and help you? Amen. Boy, I long to see those days come back out of where we're willing to help one another. Because the Bible said, woe unto him that is alone when he falleth. We're not alone tonight. We're in the body of Christ. You should never feel so isolated like you're the only one going through the valley that you're in that nobody understands. I'm telling you, God understands. And God can stir up someone in the church, you know, to come along just like Aaron and Hur. I went up and held up the hands of Moses. There are folks here tonight that want to get you by the hand and say, bless God, you can make it. You don't have to sit down and quit. You don't have to give up. For greater is he who is within you than he that's in the world. So we that are strong ought to bear the infirmity. infirmities of the weak. We ought to be a people that are helpful. I mean, the Bible said in the book of Jude, some having compassion, I'm making a difference. And you know what? The one complaint I hear as I evangelize, a lot of folks think nobody cares about them. They think the church don't even want them. But I'm telling you, there is a church that wants them. There is a church that cares. And Jesus most of all cares because he demonstrated it when he went to Calvary and he stretched out his arms on that old wooden cross. And amen, like she's saying, he didn't have to do it. But thank God he did. You know, he didn't have to save me. But thank God, I'm glad he did. And when everybody else passed by me and didn't want to get involved, I'm glad the Lord had compassion upon me. Amen. And as he had compassion, we ought to have compassion one for another tonight. Because the Bible said, and by this, amen, shall all men know that you are my disciples. He didn't say the kind of car you drive. Amen, the color of your tie. Amen, how high you jump, how fast you run. He said, but by the love that you have one to another or for another. We need to have that love to and for one another. Not just in word only, but in deed tonight. So I'm glad that there's a people that God is raising up that wants to bear the infirmity of the weak. You know, somebody that'll call you. Have you ever looked at your phone sometime and just wish somebody would call? Maybe they don't know what you're going through with, but I'm glad God is always there. Amen. Wanting to be the lifter up of your head. I wanted to console you and encourage you. And I love that scripture back in Deuteronomy. Where he talked about Israel, and he said that I bore you, amen, as a man carries his own son. I get the picture of these parents that carrying them little babies on their hip whenever they're wore out and they can't go another mile. God has carried you and I through some valleys, through some situations, and brother, as he has carried us, we ought to have that kind of compassion. And I say, let me get under there, amen, and help you carry the load. Let me pray with you and pray for you. Any good tonight that we're part of something that is alive? Amen. This church is not a dead church, but it's a glorious church. Amen. Filled with the glory of God. And brother, when you're part of this, you're part of something real. Hallelujah. Praise the Lamb of God tonight. I tell you, I feel the Holy Ghost in this house. Hallelujah. And I'm glad that God has given us some things that you and I ought to be doing. We don't have to be running around without direction. Amen. So many people, though, pray for me. Pray for me. I don't know what to do, where to go. They're kind of like that donkey that was at the crossroads and how Jesus told his disciples to go. And amen, said, you'll find him at the way where two ways meet. And you'll loose him and bring him to me. And if anybody asks you why you're doing this, I just tell them the Lord has need of him. Anytime you'll find a crossroad, a lot of times you find people who are bound up because in a desire to do the right thing, they're afraid to go right, and they're afraid to go left. So what they do is they shift into neutral, and they stay there. I'm never making any progress. I'm never getting anywhere. But oh, I'm so glad God knew where that donkey was, and he knows where you and I are in life. And just as he sent the disciples to loose it and bring it to him, God wants you and I to be, amen, objects or tools of deliverance. We're not here to bind people up. Like my old pastor used to say, if you leave here bound up tonight, then you must have brought your own rope. We're here tonight to tell you, hey man, whom the Son has set free is free indeed. And just like you preached over it, continue about Lazarus, how that he had to come forth and then he got loose. Brother, as we begin to move forward into the presence presence of God. God can deal with those things, amen, that are causing us heartache, amen, and trouble. God can help us, amen, to find our direction, amen, to find the means how to press onward, that we might be like Paul, who said, I press toward the mark for the prize at the high calling of God. Brother, I'm glad there ain't no chains on me. I'm glad he set me free.